Hello everyone. First of all, I would like to thank to the organizing and scientific committee. My name is Murat Erinç, and I am a PhD student and also research assistant at Marmara University. Today I'm going to present behavioral and electrophysiological evaluation of loudness growth in clinically normal hearing tinnitus patients with and without hyperacusis. Tinnitus is a phantom auditory sensation in the absence of external sounds. And it's a very common symptom which seen in 10 to 20% in the general population. Hyperacusis is an intolerance to everyday sounds that make daily life challenging. These ordinary sounds that do not disturb others can be overwhelmingly loud or intense. And these two of them can often seen together. While 86% of hyperacusis patients has tinnitus, 40% of tinnitus patients has hyperacusis. So, this comorbidity shows that makes us think that they may have common mechanisms, and these mechanisms are still under study. Most hypotheses state that they are related to the central auditory system. And to date, there is still uncertainty on the neural correlates of tinnitus and hyperacusis. A neural gain model is a very popular model, and it's recognized by many researchers. In this model, neural gain in the central auditory pathway is triggered by a decrease in peripheral input, which is hearing loss. But in cochlear synaptopathy or hidden hearing loss, decrease in peripheral input can also be seen in the clinically normal hearing people. In hyperacusis results, from abnormal gain along the auditory pathway in response to sound evoked activation. And tinnitus is results from increased central noise. Central gain mechanisms are common mechanisms for tinnitus, hyperacusis, and loudness perception. So in our study, we aim to evaluate the loudness growth function of tinnitus patients with and without hyperacusis using behavioral and electrophysiological methods. In our study, we have a total of 60 adults with clinically normal hearing. We choose to work with normal hearing people because we don't want to recruitment to interfere our loudness growth evaluation, and also N1 P2 wave amplitudes and latencies are affected by the hearing loss. So we have three groups, and each group has 20 subjects. We tried to balance age and genders as possible as we can. In control group, 10 male and 10 female, and their mean age are 39.8. In tinnitus group, patients has idiopathic, subjective, continuous, unilateral or bilateral tinnitus, and they have tinnitus complaints more than 3 months. 10 male and 10 female, and mean age are 40.9. In our hyperacusis group, they have tinnitus same as the tinnitus group, plus we have 3 criteria for hyperacusis. Which are, first, they should have hyperacusis complaints and hyperacusis questionnaire scores is more than 15. And at least one of the loud discomfort level results is less than 90 dB HL. And in this group, we have 7 male and 13 female. Mean age are 38.7. And we have different types of questionnaires, visual and look scale, tinnitus handicap inventory, and hyperacusis questionnaire. We did loudness discomfort levels test with the same instructions for each subject. In categorical loudness scale, we use 2 different stimuli, which is 500 and 2000 Hz narrowband noise with 7 loudness categories. In loudness cortical evoke potentials, we examine N1 P2 components with the same 2 stimuli with 40, 60, 80 decibel NHL, and these are representing soft, medium, and loud sounds. In questionnaire results, in each questionnaire, hyperacusis group's results are higher than the tinnitus group. But in tinnitus handicap inventory, hyperacusis questionnaire, tinnitus annoyance, and tinnitus effect on life were significantly different. In loudness discomfort level results, in hyperacusis group, there's again significant differences between the other two groups, but it's an expected results because our one of the hyperacusis groups criteria is loudness discomfort levels, which is it should be less than 90 dB. In loudness scale test results, we have significantly different in hyperacusis group in medium, loud, and very loud categories. And it shows that, for example, in hyperacusis group, subjects tends to say 87 decibel is loud, while in control group, subjects say 92 decibel is loud. They perceived differently. In auditory cortical evoked potentials, we couldn't find any statistically significant differences. In N1 latency, P2 latency, and N1 P2 peak-to-peak amplitude, we could not find any differences. And this figure shows that our grand mean average waveforms. And again, in different intensities and different groups, which has different colors, we could not see any differences in the waveforms. In the hyperacusis group, not only loudness discomfort levels, but also medium and loud sound intensities, according to the categorical loudness scale results, were lower than other groups. And these results indicate that hyperacusis subjects interpret moderate sounds in daily life as louder than they are. We need to pay attention that in daily life, they do not have any control over sounds. It's different from our safe test environments. For example, 80 dB is okay for them in our safe test environment, but in daily life, maybe they feel uncomfortable with that noise. There was no significant differences between the groups in cortical evaluations, and there may be some possible reasons for this. N1, P2 amplitude and latencies are affected by alertness and attention. It's because there are some interpersonal differences. And in our study, primary complaint was tinnitus, and the secondary complaint was hyperacusis. And some subjects in the tinnitus group met some of the three criteria for inclusion in the hyperacusis group. In auditory cortical evoked potentials, loudness perception occurs at the cortical level, and hyperacusis can sometimes be related to the meaning of the sounds or the emotional state of the person. So P300 seems more logical because it also includes cognitive processes. But our goal was only to observe the effect of loudness. So we examine N1 and P2 responses, which does not require active participation, and it's the highest intensity-dependent cortical potential. In conclusion, hyperacusis group had significant differences between the groups in behavioral tests, but not in electrophysiological tests. As a result, it can be suggested that the subjective responses of the patients are still the most prominent findings in the evaluation of hyperacusis. In our attempt to differentiate tinnitus and hyperacusis with electrophysiological tests based on the loudness growth function, we found that evaluating N1 and P2 responses were not seen as a suitable method, but it's worth to try with different setups or other auditory evoked potentials also. However, it appears to be beneficial to use categorical loudness scales in addition to loudness discomfort levels used in behavioral tests. Thank you for listening.